Hi, I'm Reverend Amy. Thanks for joining us. And thanks to all of you who were able to join us all summer as we worshiped in person, outdoors on the lawn of the church. And a big thanks to all of our worship hosts who helped out each week. I have a feeling that in the dark, cold depth of the winter that always comes in upstate New York, we will look back fondly on the birds singing and the summer sun and breeze we experienced as we worshiped God together outside. Outdoor worship was a step and transition toward worshiping inside our sanctuary. Worship in our sanctuary will resume on Sunday, September 12th at 9:30 a.m. We are still in the midst of a global pandemic, so COVID safety protocols are in place for worship. These include wearing a mask indoors at all times, regardless of vaccination status, and socially distanced seating with your pod in the sanctuary. Seats will need to be reserved as our capacity is limited due to the social distancing we need to observe at this point in time. Reserving those seats will be as easy as picking your seat on a flight. More information will be available in eBlast and on our website as we get closer to the 12th. We all need to be flexible and patient as we continue to do what we need to do for public health in a pandemic that is ever evolving. We are all doing the best we can, and how nice it will be to be able to loosen restrictions as the situation improves. It is a true blessing that we're able to enjoy the wisdom and gifts of Professor James Cone this morning as our guest preacher. Dr. Cone was the father of Black liberation theology and a beloved professor of mine and so many others at Union Theological Seminary and beyond. This is a sermon that Dr. Cone preached back in 2012 at the invitation of Love Your Neighbor, a group of justice-seeking United Methodists during our general conference in Tampa, Florida. That conference did not make steps toward inclusion of our LGBTQ siblings during that conference. Dr. Cone brought a word of hope and challenge to a disheartened group. These words still ring true and are perhaps even more urgently needed today to bring us hope and challenge in these days as we struggle with racial equity and justice in our country. It is a blessing to share Dr. James Cone with you today. So let's take a deep breath, center ourselves, and prepare to worship God.
I am very pleased to be invited to speak at this worship service of recognition, affirmation, and hope, and to support in whatever way I can your neighbor, love your neighbor coalition. I have heard about what has happened to you this week, but I say to you, you may be down, but you're not out. And I will speak today about a people, my people, who were down many times in our 400 years of struggle for justice. But we refused to let our enemies have the last word. Because we must remember the cross comes before the resurrection. And today may be your cross, but tomorrow you will be resurrected. And I want to speak to you today out of my people's history on the theme, the cross and the lynching tree. And call your attention to the Acts 10:39. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. The cross and the lynching tree are separated by nearly 2,000 years. One is the universal symbol of the Christian faith, and the other is the quintessential symbol of black oppression in America. Though both are symbols of death, one represents a message of hope and salvation, while the other signifies the negation of that hope by white supremacy. Despite the obvious similarities between Jesus' death on the cross and the death of thousands of black men and women strung up to die on a lamppost or tree, relatively few people have explored their symbolic connections. Yet I believe that this is the challenge we must face. What is at stake is the credibility and the promise of the Christian gospel and the hope that we may heal the wounds of racial violence that continue to divide our churches and our society today. Now, I have spent a lifetime pointing out the hypocrisy and the mendacity of the white church in a white-dominated society, while lifting up and exhausting the voices and experiences of the oppressed. I speak and I write out of my experience as an African American growing up in a segregated state of Arkansas and a close association with the civil rights and black power movements in the 1960s, as defined by Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X. But more importantly, I speak and write out of a deep theological conviction that the true power of the Christian gospel is its unambiguous call for liberation from the forces of oppression and a fierce and uncompromising condemnation of those who oppress. I speak and I write on behalf of those whom the Salvadorian theologian and martyr Ignacio Ella Curia called the crucified people of history. I write for the forgotten and the abused, for the marginalized and the despised. I write for those who are penniless and jobless, landless, and those who have no political or social power. I speak and I write for gays, for lesbians, bisexuals, and those who are transgender, the queer people of this world. I write for the undocumented farm workers toiling in misery in our nation's agricultural fields. I write and speak for Muslims who live under the terror of war and empire in Iraq and Afghanistan. And I speak and write for all people who care about humanity. I believe that until we, especially preachers, theologians, and Christians, until we can see the cross and the lynching tree together, until we can identify Christ with a re-crucified body hanging from a lynching tree, or a gay body on a picket fence, There can be no genuine understanding of Christian identity in America or the world, and no deliverance from the brutal legacy of slavery and white supremacy and homophobia and what all those evils that kill and exploit human beings on this earth. As I started reading about lynching in America and about the historical situation of crosses in Rome during Jesus' time, my question was, how did African Americans survive and resist the lynching terror? How did they do it? There were nearly 5,000 African American men, women, and children who were lynched in America following the Civil War, and their devastated families were left behind to cope with the great loss. To live every day under the terror of death was no easy matter. I grew up in Arkansas, a lynching state. I know from experience something about lynching. I watched my mother and father deal with it. But the moment I read about it, examining it historically, I had to ask, how did blacks survive? How did they keep their sanity in the midst of all that terror? I discovered, as strange and as paradoxically as it may appear, it was the cross. It was their faith in Jesus' cross. Their faith in Jesus' cross, believing that if God was with Jesus, God must be with us because we are up on the cross too. My other question was, how could white Christians who say they believe that Jesus died on the cross to save them, how could they then turn around and put blacks on the crosses and crucify them just like the Romans crucified Jesus? That was an amazing paradox to me. African Americans used faith to survive and to resist, while whites used their faith in order to terrorize black people. Two communities, both Christian, embracing the same faith. Whites even did lynchings on church grounds. How could they do it? That's where my passion comes from as I write and talk about the cross and the lynching tree. That's where the paradox comes from in my writings. That's where the theological wrestling comes from. Like Jacob wrestling with a man until daybreak, refusing to let go until he was blessed. Many Christians embrace the conviction that Jesus died on the cross to save humankind from sin. Taking our place, we say, Jesus suffered on the cross and gave his life as a ransom for many. The cross is the great symbol of the Christian narrative of salvation. Unfortunately, during the course of 2,000 years of Christian history, the cross as a symbol of salvation has been detached from the ongoing suffering and oppression of human beings, the crucified people of history. The cross has been transformed into a harmless, non-offensive ornaments that Christians wear around their necks. Rather than reminding us of the cost of discipleship, It has become a form of cheap grace, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer put it, an easy way to salvation that doesn't force us to confront the power and the meaning of Christ's message and mission. In reflecting on the cross and the lynching tree, I found my inspiration in the Black church, along with writers such as James Baldwin, Albert Camus, and Richard Wright, as well as in the great blues artists of my youth. These artists and writers gave me a sense of awe in the presence of suffering humanity, fighting for justice against great odds. I saw that for most ordinary Blacks, it was the religion and the blues that offered them sources of hope, that there was more to life than what one encountered daily in the white man's world. In the words of the great poets and writers, and in the great blues singers, and in the thunderous voices of the Black church, I discovered those who were able to confront the bleak circumstances of their lives, and yet defy fate and suffering, and make the most of what living life had to offer them. Through these connections, I found my voice as a theologian, which birthed forth in my first book, Black Theology and Black Power, in 1969. I understood that when people do not want to be themselves, but somebody else, that's utter despair. A sickness unto death, as Kierkegaard wrote about it. And I knew that faith informed by the blues was the one thing that white people could not control or take away from African Americans. And as the bluesman Robert Johnson put it, I got to keep moving. I got to keep moving, blues falling like hell, and the day keeps worrying me. There's a hellhound on my trail. After reading Baldwin and Camus and Richard Wright, I wanted to go back to graduate school and study literature and get another PhD at the University of Chicago in the 1960s under the tutelage of the Negro professor Nathan Scott Jr., widely regarded as the creator and the leading scholar in the field of theology and literature. Now, although Nathan Scott and I talked about it, the Black Freedom Movement was too urgent for me to return to school. America's cities were burning, and Blacks were being shot down in the school, in the streets. And I said to myself, you already have a PhD. If you ain't got nothing to say now after 6 years of graduate study, you ain't never gonna have anything to say. And I said, forget school. Sit your butt down in that chair and write what you think. Now, although I wrote a PhD dissertation on the great Swiss theologian Karl Barth, I never taught a course on him. Because I like people who talk and write about the real, concrete world where people are suffering. And unless I can feel it in my gut, I can't say it. The poor help me to say it because I feel their pain. the literary and the activist people help me to say it, because they write about suffering with imagination and power. James Baldwin is my favorite. Martin King is next. Malcolm X is the third person of my Trinity. The poets and the orators give me energy. Theologians talk too much about things far removed, way out there in some intellectual stratosphere which only they inhabit. They talk to each other. They give each other degrees. The real world is not out there where they live and think. So that is why I turn to the poets and to the activists. They talk to people I know and people I love, the marginalized and the poor of this world. Being a Christian is like being black. It's a paradox. A profound contradiction. You grow up black, and you can't help but wonder why whites treat you like that. It's hard to figure out, especially as an innocent child as I was growing up in Arkansas. And yet at the same time, my mother and daddy told me, don't you hate like they hate. If you do, you will self-destruct. Hate kills the hater, and not necessarily the hated. It was my parents' faith that gave me the inner resources to transcend the brutality and see the real beauty in the tragedy of their lives. It's a mystery, a profound and deep mystery, how African Americans, after 2.5 centuries of slavery, another century of lynching and Jim Crow segregation, and yet still come out loving white people. Now, many whites who hear me talk and write like that and read my books don't think I love them, but I do. They always have a strange expression on their faces when I say that, and look at me as if I must be kidding. But you see, I am very serious when I say I love white people, because the deeper the love, the more the passion, especially when the ones you love hurt you. You are their brothers and sisters, and yet they treat you like enemies. The paradox is this: in spite of slavery, lynching, and segregation, African Americans are the only people, are the people who never organized to take down America. We have fought in every war of America, even when we weren't wanted. We have sacrificed our lives and for our nation and for the church that despised us. Yet no matter what they do to us, we still come out whole, still searching for that transcendent meaning that whites cannot take away. I think the resources for survival and resistance in oppression are found in black culture and religion, our faith and culture. The blues and the spirituals gave us a sense that we were not what others said we were. The cross is a paradoxical religious symbol, because it inverts the world's value system. with the good news that hope comes by way of defeat, that suffering and death do not have the last word, that the last shall be first and the first last. The idea is absurd to the intellect, yet profoundly real in the spiritual lives of the Black religious experience. For those who were lynched, the crucified Christ manifests God's loving and liberating presence in the contradictions of Black life. The cross of Jesus is that transcendent presence in the lives of Christians, which empower them to believe that ultimately in God's eschatological future, they will not be defeated by the troubles of this world, no matter how great and painful their suffering. This paradox, this absurd faith, was the only possible one for those who were powerless, who were unable to be, proud and mighty, one who understood that people are not called to be ruled over by others. The cross of Christ is God's critique of power with powerless love, snatching victory out of defeat. What I am talking about actually is about love. It's something you cannot prove empirically or articulate adequately, but the truth of it is self-evident in living it. I have seen the transforming power of this faith in the cross among many Black Christians who struggle, especially among the Black freedom fighters in the civil rights movement. Many knew that they were going to be beaten and tortured and possibly even killed. They knew that they were not going to win the obvious way of winning, but they had to do what they did because the transcendent reality encountered in their fight for justice was more powerful than their opposition, more meaningful than that which contradicted it. People respond to what empowers them inside, that spirit that lets them know that they are somebody when the world treats them as nobody. When you can act out of that spirit, then you know there is a reality in this world bigger than you. And that's what Black religion bears witness to. In all of its flaws, it bears witness to a spiritual resource that empowers marginalized people to do things that seem impossible. I grew up with that. I really don't ever remember wishing I was white, because being Black was so wonderful and beautiful, especially as I saw Blackness embodied in my mother and father and in the host of other Black men and women in Arkansas. There may have been moments when I might have had the desire to be white, may have crossed my mind, but I don't remember. The reality of love in my own community was so strong that I did not have time to think about being white. the spiritual values of my parents and other blacks were much more important than the material things I saw in the white community that hated me. Black music, black preaching, black loving, black dancing, everything black was much more interesting and inspiring. Blackness saved me from whiteness. And kept me sane, believing that I was somebody no matter what people did to me. How do people know that they are not what the world says when they have so few political and social resources to defend their humanity? So few economic resources to even physically survive, and so few educational resources in order to express their somebodyness. For blacks in the U.S., it was their faith, which is inseparable from their culture. That was why I call the blues secular spirituals. The blues are spiritual resources, a cultural power that enables people to express their humanity. James Baldwin only finished high school. Richard Wright only the ninth grade. And they had their say and bore witness to a transcendence in blackness that no one could destroy. Blackness is the image of God in black people. It is the light in the white darkness. B.B. King never got out of grade school. And Louis Armstrong hardly went to any school at all. Now I said to myself, if Louis Armstrong could blow a trumpet like that, forget it. I'm going to write theology the way Louis Armstrong blows that trumpet. And the way Billie Holiday sings Strange Fruit. I want to reach deep down in my black being for those cultural, spiritual resources that enable African Americans to express themselves when the world said they had nothing to say. People who resist create hope and love of humanity. The civil rights struggle was a mass movement that was defined by love. You always have both sides. You always have bad faith and good faith. I like to speak and write about the good faith. Faith that resists. Faith that empowers. Faith that enables people to look another in the eye and tell them what you think. Now, I remember growing up in Arkansas, there were a lot of masks. As Paul Lawrence Dunbar put it, we wear the mask that grins and lies. I wore a mask in Arkansas as a child when I went to white people's town in Bearden and other places, but I didn't wear one in my own community. I wore a mask in the white community because I knew what they could do to you and your family. I wore a mask even in graduate school because I had to find a way to excel in an academic environment that did not acknowledge my black existence. But I kept saying to myself, one of these days I'm going to take that mask off and say what I think to white people and make up for lost time. And so, the last 40-something years, that's what I've been doing. I write and encourage African Americans to get in touch with that inner spiritual resource, that empowering spirit, in order that you may have your say. And say it as clearly and as forcefully and as truthfully as you can. Not all blacks could do that, because white people have a lot of power. And many white churches exist, but most are not the real thing. They are just loving each other. People in their own group, excluding others. That's all they do, is socialize with each other, at least most of the time. You seldom find a church that has any diversity in it. Now, how can that be Christian? That's why I'm glad at this service. It's diverse. God was in Christ reconciling the world unto God's self. Well, it was in the white churches that the white God and a white Christ enslaved and separated blacks from the white community. Today, black and white churches are doing the same thing, excluding queer people from their community, saying, I love the sinner, hate the sin. Now, I never heard Jesus say that. It's like saying, I love black people, but I don't want them in my community. I don't want them in my church. But I say, as long as you are silent and do nothing about homophobia and white supremacy and all these other evils, you are just as guilty as the one who hung black on trees and queer people on picket fences. Just like Peter was silent when the Romans hung Jesus on the cross. Black Simon took up the cross that Simon Peter was supposed to bear. If you are going to worship somebody that was nailed to a tree, you must know that the life of a disciple of that person is not going to be easy. You may end up on a tree too. Just like Jesus, blacks and gays that whites and straight people despise. And so in this sense, we have to take seriously the Christian faith, or else we will end up doing the opposite of what that faith means. Now, my mother and father did not have my opportunity. And when I write and speak, therefore, I think of them and try to speak for them. They never had a chance to stand before white people and tell them what they think. I have to do it for them somehow. I try to do that all over the world. I think of Lucy and Charlie Cohn and all the other Lucys and Charlie Cohns who are out there, and I try to speak for them. I think of them and not of myself. I think of them and feel their spirit flowing through my body, encouraging me to speak the truth. They deepen my spirituality and give me something to hold on to that I can feel and that I can touch. It is a very spiritual experience because we are doing something for people who cannot and will never have a chance to speak for themselves. So why do I need to speak for me? I need to speak for those people, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, who have been left out of the sunlight of opportunity. If you feel passion in my voice, and if you feel energy in any books you read by me, that's because I'm thinking of Lucy and Charlie Cone, my daddy and mama, and all the other many marginalized daddies and mamas out there. And if I can do that, I think I'll stay on the right track. Amen.
Send out in Jesus' name, our hands are ready now to make the earth the place in which the kingdom comes. Send out in Jesus' name, our hands are ready now to make the earth the place in which the kingdom comes. The angels cannot change a world of hurt and pain into a world of love, of Jesus and of peace. The task is ours to do, and ever really free. Oh, help us to obey.